This session is going to be on the Trademarks Act 1999. So let's talk about the significance of the trademark. Why is it a trademark as an important intellectual property? Why is it so? So this is one of the questions which everybody will ask. And people know that we are using day in and day out our trademarks in our everyday life. So let me start with saying, what does the trademark protect and what is the significance of the trademark? The trademark as an intellectual property offers protection of word, signature, name, device, logo, label, numerals, or combination of colors represented in graphical and visual form. So it is commonly known as brand. The moment I say it's a brand, everybody knows, hey, it's a brand. But the legal term of the brand is a trademark. So let's understand that a commonest language is a brand, and what is used in our legal term is trademark, right? Now, what does the trademark law protects? The trademark law protects the registered owner of the trademark from unlawful exploitation and passing off goods or services by others. What does it mean? For example, if Sony makes a television and sells it in the market, and somebody else makes a television and brands it as Sony and then sells it in the market, it is a counterfeit product, but the brand name used or the trademark used is Sony. So this is an unlawful exploitation of the goods and reputation of others. So Sony by itself has claimed over a period of time an image, reputation, and goodwill in the marketplace for its brand or for its mark. Now somebody cannot claim an ownership to that. That is the criteria which the trademark law protects the registered owner of the trademark. Right? Unlawful exploitation is what is protected. Now, the registered trademark owner has exclusive rights for using a mark in trade and commerce. Basically, the trademarks are used only in trade and commerce, mainly, majority of the time it is, because they have to exploit the business potential by using the brand value. You know, today it's what's the brand value. So today I talk about an Audi car or a Mercedes Benz or a BMW, you know that it's a brand by itself. So there is a potential for that particular brand. Or if you look at Maruti car, you know, it has got its mass brand image. So like the people will say, India comes home in a Maruti. That's a slogan which they were advertising sometime back. So that means India comes home in a Maruti, which is a trademark. That means that their brand, their reputation is that majority of the people are owning a Maruti car and India comes home in Maruti. Similarly, for example, you see our own Indian grown brand like Amul, the taste of India. What does it say? That means it's consumed by all the people all over India. That is the taste of India, the Amul. So like that, so the brand has got its value, its reputation and goodwill built over a period of time in the marketplace. Now, as you can see, the last point which of the slide, we use trademark in our everyday life. I was telling, day in, day out, we are using brand. If you want to buy a car, you select your budget and then compare the choices available to you and then select the particular car that suits your lifestyle, fashion, and budget, right? Similarly, a bike, or if you want to buy a mobile phone, whether you want to buy a 1 lakh rupees mobile phone or a 50,000 rupees mobile phone or 25,000 rupees mobile phone or 10,000 rupees mobile phone, and you have brands available in each. And each brand comes with this association and image, what is conceived as an image in the minds of the consumer. That is important. So, and the reputation it carries and the goodwill it offers. So somebody buys a product because, hey, I bought this product. I brought this particular brand of mobile phone. It has been working for 3 years without any problem. No battery drain, nothing this way. Like that, you keep giving recommendation to people. So what does it mean? That the brand has established an image, reputation, and goodwill in the minds of the consumer. A watch, for that example, you know, Swiss watch is costing very heavy. Our own Indian brand, Titan. I mean, those days we used to have the HMT watches. That was the beginning. Now Titan is one of the leading brands of India, and there are many other brands in the market which are at varying price levels depending on the brand value. What does the branding allow you? Branding allows you to exploit the market potential to the fullest extent, gaining a better price also, price realization also. That is what we call it as a brand value or the market capitalization, where you gain more for the brand value which it offers, right? Now, as I said, even household goods, whether you want to buy a TV, fridge, washing machine, even your day-to-day consumption, which honey to use, whether I'll use Dabur honey or I'll use this Saffola honey or I'll use this other honey, you look at it like atta, which atta I will use. No, ITC atta, Chakki Fresh atta, Annapurna atta. You have so many brand names. Anil atta, which atta you will use? It is all depends on your personal choice, affordability, and budget. And you carry an image that this particular brand is good enough for me, for my purpose, and for my use. That is how it is. Similarly, rice. Rice, you have different brands which you can use. Similarly, salt. Annapurna salt or Tata salt or any other salt for that matter, cooking oil. There is a big competition. Every day you see the jingles in the TV. I use this kadal enna, use that vanilla enna, use this tenga enna. You know, all this cooking oil, people keep on giving jingles after jingles. Oh, this is the best oil. This has no palm oil in content. It's the purest oil. You know, somebody says LDA coconut oil of Kalishwari. Somebody says it's parachute of the Saffola brand, Marigold Industries. Everybody is trying to promote soaps. I don't have to say, you have starting with 10 rupees soap to, even a soap costing 6,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees soaps. Okay. And shampoos, floor cleaners, even the floor cleaners, which you have so many brands are competing to fight it out. So each brand has got its reputation. If you want to buy, you will go and say, I want this brand. I only piece that. What happens once you get tied to the brand? We will see it later in the next slides. You are going to use that brand continuously. That is a point which you need to understand. So let's trace back history and how this origin and development of trademark has taken place. So because normally I touch upon the history because it's a little bit interesting to know about the history, how it has developed into the concept what it is today. So we look into the origin and development of trademark. So concept of trademark existed in ancient times to identify ownership and origin. Even those people who are using the hunters, they used to have some tools and all that. See, even in the Harappa civilization, we found that there are some goods. Even in Indian, South Indian, they're saying we have goods which are marked with specific thing. And we would have heard about Chera Chola Pandya kingdoms, what we know known as the Raja Muthirai. The authority, the seal of the authenticity of the king, what do you call it as Rajamuthirai? Rajamuthirai, it is a stamp of seal of authenticity or genuineness or whatever it is. So those kind of marks did exist. Even Ramayana, Kanayadi, Anuman has shown to Sita to show that it's a mark. Because Sita knows that it is this brand or this thing belongs to so-and-so. That's a, recall, the brand recall or whatever you call it as. So that's the point of this thing. So concept of trademark existed in ancient times to identify ownership and origin. And also it started with Baker's marking law in 1266. Okay. What happened was they enabled the bakers to mark the loaves of bread to distinguish the goods from similar goods of others. Each baker will put, you would have heard that hot cross buns songs and all that. So you put a cross there, it becomes one baker's. You put a circle and a cross, it becomes another baker's product. Like that, even in those items, they just start putting the mark and make it, to distinguish the goods from others. What happens is one person may be giving a particular quality of the goods. Other person may not be giving the same quality. Maybe there is a difference. See, if this person is giving 100% quality of the good and taste, which you like, the other person may be giving you 90% or 95%. There is a difference in the percentage of the taste or this whatever the content of it or whatever the nutrient content of it or whatever it is. So to distinguish between one person's product and another person's product and not to mix up the products of each other, so the market come into picture. Initially, as I said, it was basically to identify the ownership and origin, from where it has come and who is the owner of that. Now, the first law enacted in India was Trademarks Act 1940. Prior to that, it was based on the common law as in England. So even this 1940 Act was nothing but the 1938 Act of the England. It is almost the same. So again, it was replaced in 1958 and it was further amended in line with the TRIPS agreement in 1999. In 1999, it was amended be in line with the convention which was signed under WTO agreement, World Trade Organization. The TRIPS agreement is an important agreement which was signed by many countries. India is a signatory to it. Once we have done it, I covered this in my previous lecture of intellectual property, right? Little bit elaborately on TRIPS agreement, why TRIPS came into existence and why it is a trade-related intellectual property agreement was important for protecting and enforcing the trademark, the IP rights of all the interested persons. Now, after that, I talked about the WIPO also, that is World Intellectual Property Organization. WIPO is a part of United Nations. It is one of the organs of the United Nations. And it promotes three things. Basically, it is taking care of the patents under the Patent Cooperation Treaty, the Madrid Protocol. That's what we call it as a Madrid Protocol. Madrid is the capital of Spain. And there was it was agreed in the Madrid Protocol that 123 countries have signed and then said, okay, we will have a universal way of registering the trademark. So if I go through this Madrid Protocol, I can, sitting in India, I can apply through WIPO and get the trademark of my company or whatever it is registered in the 123 convention countries which are parties to this Madrid Protocol signing. So it is a convenient and cost-effective solution for registering trademarks worldwide. What happens is, when you go through the Madrid Protocol, the reply whether your trademark is approved or not approved will come to you within a year's period. 12 months to 18 months period, and the centralized cost which WIPO collects from you. And whereas if you have to apply individually to different countries, for example, we talked about IP mostly as a territorial in nature. Over country, it is protected by the law within that particular territory. But however, with respect to this Madrid Protocol, the WIPO is a centralized system which allows you to register the trademark world over, sitting from your parent country, which is a signatory of this thing. And India has acceded to the Madrid Protocol on 8th July 2013, right? Now, it is also permissible in law to register a trademark under Copyright Act as an artistic work. Supposing your trademark, it's a logo, nicely written, a logo with a label mark. It has got both words as well as a symbol or whatever it is, combination of that. So we call it as a composite or a label, okay? So words, numerals, and images, all these things put together. So once it is in artistic in nature, in addition to your trademark protection, you can also get a copyright registered for it. So I can show you some examples here locally from South India. One is this Ram Raj Cotton Dhotis and all that company. I think they are from Tirupur. So they have copyrighted the Ram Raj word is, I think it is protected by trademark. And the symbol of a temple, an artistic way of depicting the temple, they have copyrighted with the Ram Raj words into it as a copyright also. So you can see both C mark as well as R mark in the Ram Raj products. Similarly, the cycle brand Agarbattis, we would have seen the cycle brand Agarbattis. This is from Mysore. They also have registered their trademark as well as their cover designs. Each and every carton or cover design of that is also registered as a copyright. Basically, we call it as a trade dress when we talk in trademark parlance. So let's see what are the functions of a trademark. What are the functions of a trademark? So the functions of the trademark, it identifies the goods or services and its origin. So it identifies what is a good, I mean the goods from which origin. Origin means which manufacturer or which person, like made in India, made in China, made in, we always put it, no, the origin of the goods and the manufacturer of the goods. Okay. For example, a Sony television could be made in India too. It's not necessarily that it should be there. It should be made in Japan only. So it can, it will say Sony and made in India. So that means it comes from the manufacturer who is Sony, but the origin of the goods is from India, or it can be coming in from Indonesia or coming from Malaysia. Like that, they might have manufactured in those factories which are there in that particular origin. So origin and the identification. And what does it guarantee? Guarantees unchanged or basically the consistent quality. So if I buy this particular television product, I know that this will give a consistent quality throughout its lifetime. That's the meaning of it. Or if I buy, say, for example, one of the drinks like Horlicks, whether the Horlicks has got the consistency over a period of time, people who have used it will say, will vouch for it. Yes, the consistency of quality of Horlicks has been found to be the same taste throughout my lifetime. Well, whatever period I have started using it, I find the taste has been the same. There is no inconsistency, or the quality is not changed. The quality is maintained, or it is always consistent. That is, it guarantees. So this is a function of a trademark. And what happens? It also advertises the goods or services. One of the biggest thing is to advertise the goods. So once the goods are advertised, it becomes a brand to be recalled. So finally, what it does, the function it does, it creates an image, goodwill, and reputation for the goods or services. These are the three things which a brand or a trademark function. Now let's come into our act. What does our act say? The Indian Act say, Section 2 ZB of Trademark Act 1999 defines trademark means a mark capable of being represented graphically and which is capable of distinguishing the goods of or services of one person from those of others. So if I offer a service, how do I distinguish my service? Say I may be in, for example, like door delivery of food. So today, if everybody knows Swiggy la order panna dinner, Swiggy la order panna Swiggy, or order in Zomato, or order in Uber Eats, like that you have services, but all the three things are doing the same service of door delivery of food service. Now if somebody XYZ company wants to get into the same field, they have to identify with them with the new brand image, so that they can distinguish the services of theirs from those already existent in the market. It is also the same product. Similarly, for example, you would have seen in TV, TMT rods, which are used in construction industry. Every manufacturer in Tamil Nadu will come up with an advertisement. They'll say, use my TMT, this Shakti TMT, Agni TMT, this TMT, that TMT. Now you would have seen. So any new entrant also which comes in, they have to necessarily have a mark which is capable of being represented graphically or in words or a composite way, and it is capable of distinguishing the goods or services of one person from that of other person. Other person means here, the person means both a natural person as well as a legal person. Maybe a company or entity also comes under that category. Let's talk about Section 2M. What does the Section 2M say? Section 2M says, mark includes a device, brand, heading, label, ticket, name, signature, word, letter, numeral, shape of goods, packing, or combination of colors, or any combination thereof. So any of these things constitute a mark. The mark na enna endradhu Section 2M la kuduthirukanga. That's what it is, as you can see from there. Now Section 2W says the registered trademark means a trademark which is actually on the register and remaining in force. Okay, so you can see a R symbol here, the R symbol of the registered trademark. So means it's the trademark is registered. Okay, now Section 2ZG, which is class subsection 2ZG, where it defines about a well-known trademark. Well-known trademark means a mark which has become so to the substantial segment of the public which uses such goods or receives such services. So I talked about Amul, the Taste of India. So almost all over India, a substantial segment of the public in India knows Amul as a brand which gives Amul milk, Amul butter, Amul cheese, Amul, and now started they coming with cow ghee also. So flavored milk, buttermilk, Amul thing, right? Similarly, within Tamil Nadu, if you look at it, Avin. When you say Avin, it knows it is a well-known trademark within the public of Tamil Nadu. It's a substantial segment of public in Tamil Nadu knows that it is Avin is a well-known trademark, right? Similarly, I told you about Maruti. Maruti car means all over India, people know, and it becomes a well-known trademark. So it is also possible to apply for a well-known trademark and get it from the trademark registry. So for this, there are specific means, and you will have to provide evidence to that effect that it is gained a substantial acceptance of the consumer, of the public. That's a thing. So when you say well-known trademark, we also associate a term called trans-border reputation. Trans-border reputation. What is a trans-border reputation? Because Toyota is a well-known brand name all over India, all over the world, because whichever country they are selling their cars, they are well-known. Honda, Yamaha, Japanese brands or American brands or French brands or Indian brands for that matter, Mahindra, Tata, which they are. These are all well-known brands. Tata, when I say Tata, they are a well-known trademark in India. Not only in India, they are operating in many countries. So, well-known trademark is an important aspect which you need to know, and it has got trans-border reputation. Trans-border reputation means cutting across the borders of the countries, you have a reputation and known as a well-known trademark. Basically, these are definitions, because I have to take you through the concept before I go into the actual process of registration and then going about it. So just to give you an emphasis on the law, because when you are writing some exams or other things, you need to know the sections. So I've just put the sections and then explaining it with the details. Now, what is the purpose of trademark system? Let us understand why do we need a trademark system. So as I said earlier, it is identifies the actual physical origin of goods and services. The brand itself is a seal of authenticity because of its distinctiveness. See, brands are always distinctive. They are not descriptive. So you will have to understand that even when you are going for a new registration of a trademark, it cannot be descriptive in nature. It has to be distinctive mark. It has to distinguish, as I said, the fundamental thing is it has to distinguish your goods or service from that of others who are offering the same goods or service in the marketplace. So you have to differentiate yourself. Distinguish yourself. So that means your mark has to be distinct and you cannot be similar. The other terminology we will learn is deceptively similar. As we talked about substantial similarity in copyright, that is a substantial similarity. Here in trademark parlance, we use it as a deceptive similarity. So deceptive similarity is a substantial similarity we have talked about last week in copyright, that original work is the copied work is infringed work is something substantially similar to the original work. Similarly, in trademark parlance, we call it as a deceptive similarity. It is deceptive. Why it is called deceptive? Because the buyer or the consumer will get confused whether this is the same brand or that is the same brand, like that. So it creates a confusion in the public mind. So that is why I am expanding the meaning of this distinctiveness. So I hope you understand the meaning of distinctiveness with respect to trademark. It has to be 100% distinct and able to distinguish the goods and services of one company or one product with that of another product. Now, what does it guarantee? It guarantees the identity of the origin of goods and service. It stimulates further purchase. As I said, if you have started using, the brands of toothpaste, you have Colgate, you have Pepsodent, you have Dabur, you have other things, right? And you start using them as per your plan, and you go and buy the same brand, whatever brand you have chosen. Most often you go and buy the same brand, you don't change the brand, because you have created a liking to it or affordability to it or whatever to it, and you are using that for your repeat purchase. What we call it as a repeat purchase and a brand recall. Now it also serves as a badge for loyalty and affiliation. So you are loyal to that particular brand. So that is why you are doing a repeat purchase, as well as you are affiliate. By means of loyalty, you are creating an affiliation to that particular brand. So it is affiliated to you. It may enable consumer to make a lifestyle or a fashion statement. So where does it come into picture? So for example, if I use a particular brand of a watch, so when I'm in a party or whenever I go there, I can say I can make a fashion statement. Okay, look, I'm wearing a $10,000 Rado watch with a golden frame or something. Or I use a Mercedes-Benz as my car or whatever, depending on your this thing. So it could be a lifestyle which suits your lifestyle, or it could be a fashion statement by the user of the particular brand. Most important thing, the last but not the least, it enables the consumer to make an informed decision from the many available choice of same goods or services. Okay. So here, what happens is, now even for a salt, even for a dal which you use, arahar dal, toor dal, thoram parppu, kadala parppu, paasi parppu, all the dals you use in your day to day this thing, you have so many brands. You have a Tata brand, you have a local brand, you have All India brand, you have so many brands coming. How are you informed? You, by giving the choices, you will be reading through the choices, you will be reading the labels, you will be seeing how much of the expiry and what are the things which are available to you. What does they advertise? How do they advertise? What is the point they say? What is the, see, most of the advertisement bring on the USP, that is unique selling proposition, what we call it as a USP. That USP is shown to you, and you look into that and then say, okay, this particular brand should be good for me or good for or not for me. So it enables you to make an informed decision. Supposing you are looking for a 1.2 liter engine car. You know, there are so many brands available. So you will say whether I go for a normal car, petrol car or a diesel car or a turbocharged petrol car or this car, that car, you will just look into it. You'll see what is the power, what is this thing, everything. So, you are able to compare the choices available before you and select the choice which you are there. Nowadays, people are able to decide by going through the specifications or going through the contents of it. And then you are able to make an informed decision. Yes, this is good enough for my lifestyle. I don't need this particular thing. It's more expensive, and I don't need this much capacity liter engine. This is good enough for me. I don't need a 1.5 liter. I don't need a 2 liter engine. For me, 1.2 liter engine is good enough. Like that, you can decide for yourself, because you are able to have, it's an information age, as you all know, it's an information age. So you will make an informed decision from the choices available to you. Now here I want to make the story from Silapadigaram, which everybody must be aware. சிலப்பதிகாரத்தில் கண்ணகியோட கதையை பத்தி இங்க பேசலாம் லிட்டில் பிட். அண்ட் வாட் இளங்கோ அடிகள் தி ஆத்தர் ஹேட் டன் வாஸ் தி ஸ்டோரி ரிவால்வ்ஸ் அரவுண்ட் தி பாண்டியர் கிங் நெடுஞ்செழியன் ஒன். ஓகே, நெடுஞ்செழியன் ஒன் ஆஃப் மதுரை. ஸோ ஹி வாஸ் அ ரூலர் ஆஃப் த பாண்டியா கிங்டம், அண்ட் திஸ் புவர் லேடி கோஸ் டு ஹிஸ் கோர்ட் ஆஸ் ஹர் ஹஸ்பண்ட் வாஸ் பிஹேடட் பை தி கிங் பிகாஸ் ஹி அக்யூஸ்ட் ஹிம் ஆஃப் stealing the anklet of the queen. Okay, although it was a mischief played by the goldsmith of the king, without ordering any inquiry, he sentenced him to be beheaded. That is one part of it. I am not coming to the criminal side or a civil side, justice side of it. I'm coming from the intellectual property side. Let's turn the story to the intellectual property. How does the intellectual property play a game there? He had the anklets, what do you call it in Tamil as silambu. So Kannagi had the anklet with rubies on it, the red stones, manikam, what we call in Tamil as manikam. Whereas, as you know, the Pandi Nadu Muthudaithu nu vaanga, Sola Nadu Sorudaithu, Pandi Nadu Muthudaithu. The Pandya Mannaroda Raniyoda idhila silambula irundhathu muthukal, ven muthukal. So what did she say? You see in Marina Beach, there's a statue of Kannagi with an anklet in her hand, where she had burned the city of Madurai for not given justice. Okay. Now, when she broke open that anklet, it was all red stones going out. Okay. Now, had they branded it or trademarked it that this is the anklet with ruby, this is a particular brand. It's a anklet with a simple thing, a simple mark on that would have definitely made the king to take a right decision. So maybe the I from the IP angle, I look at it, there was no trademark available on the anklet to distinguish. But many people, you know, nowadays, all those who were buying regularly the gold jewelries and going to the shops and all that, you know that each and every jeweler puts his mark on that. And they see it with the lens, you know, they put a lens there and see whether it is KDM or 916 and which maker. And if it is the same jeweler, you go and then, for example, I'm just getting the name because brands, we can't stop without talking about the names or the brands. If you go to GRT or Umudi, if you have bought the jewel from them, he will say 100% I will give you the same value on today's rate for exchange of the gold. But if it is some other manufacturer, you will say I'll deduct 3%, 4% from the value of it. So where does that come? It comes from the mark on the jewelry. Okay. So maybe during the period of Pandya King Nedunjadiya I, there was no trademark system in place. So there was the purpose of trademark was defeated. So there was not, he was not able to identify whether this is his own wife's anklet or that of Kannagi. He believed the words of the other person without having verified a mark of that particular thing. So it's a small story apart to just to bring in a IP angle to it. Okay. So having said that, let's come into the kinds of marks which are available. Okay. What are the kinds of mark available? Let us look into it. So we have conventional marks. As you know, conventional marks are word mark, device mark, composite mark, or label mark, numeric, numeral, sticker, shape of goods, symbols, etc. Okay, these are conventional marks. You can put a word, say like Bata. Bata, the way and style it is there. Or MakeMyTrip.com. MakeMyTrip.com has made it as a brand. There was a case also where there is Get My Trip or something was put in, and that was well defended by MakeMyTrip.com. And they have different kind of two or three trademarks. Make My Trip. The whole thing was also trademarked. Also the My is Make My Trip. No, the My is in red color. They have also put that style as a distinctive feature of their trademark. And then they got protection with two, three marks also, right? Now, what about the collective mark? No, there is an association mark. So we can know Olympic Association mark or IPL mark or FIFA World Cup. So they will have symbols and other things which are used by the association. So World Cup, you know, teams and other things, they will have all those kind of association. Any association which is using a mark, and that mark is shared, it's not a proprietorship concern. It's like that Section 25 company under the Companies Act 2013. No, the Section 25 company is a non-profit making company. It is an association. For example, a Builders Association of India and, Lorry Owners Association of India, Film Media Personals Association of India, like that, they may have an association. And that association may have a logo or symbol or whatever it is. It is a collection of institutions and individuals who become part of that particular mark. So that is why it is known as a collective mark. Even some society mark, the society mark, is also an association of so many people who form a society. The society members could be an institutional members or individual members, and then an association is formed. This is not an association of partnership or limited company purpose. It is an association for a particular product which everybody is engaged in a particular. So I hope this is clear to you. This is a collective mark. And then there is a certification mark which is also given. Which is certification mark is, the BIS, Bureau of Indian Standards. Earlier it was known as ISI, Indian Standard Institution. Name has been changed to be BIS. And then the BIS mark is there. And then AgMark, you all know it's for the agricultural products. So AgMark means AgMark ghee, AgMark this oil, like whatever the food and extractive products, AgMark is given in India. Then we have for the gold jewelry, Hallmark 916. 916 Hallmark jewelry means it has a quality level of 91.6% of gold, and rest of them the alloy, whatever they add, copper and other things which is going to be there. So when you get a certificate for that product, see, the every jeweler, when he subjects his mark to for hallmarking, it means that he is subjecting it to a certification of his product. So these are certification marks. Then we have what is known as unconventional marks. So in India, we have not given the provisions for unconventional mark, although some are recognized by our courts during the process. As you can see, the sound mark is one of the things, small sounds which comes with the thing, like, you know, the MGM lion. This is MGM, is that not our MGM in East Coast Road. It is a MGM, what we call it, the Metro Goldwyn Mayer, the film production company of the America, where you know that a lion will come out and then will roar when initially the picture comes into picture, so to show that it is produced by MGM, Metro Goldwyn Mayer. So that's a sound mark. That sound is also a trademark which is there. Then you see the Intel advertisements. You will see a ping ding, some bell kind of a thing, ding dong kind of a thing, which is an Intel sound. And you also have the Airtel sound compiled by our AR Rahman, which is also a sound mark. Okay, so each and everybody want to have a particular. And again, in this category of sound mark, now you know, Apple iPhone will have a different color tune. Xiaomi phone will have a different color tune. The ringtone, not the color tune, ringtone. Or the Samsung will have its own color ringtone. So each and every manufacturer would like to have their own kind of a ringtone to show that they are different, to distinguish their product from that of others. These are called as unconventional mark. There is also a color mark, which is given, but India under Section 10 of Trademarks Act, there is a limitation laid in Indian Act with regard to color, because India does not want to give color marks to everybody or a combination of colors to different. There are some color combinations they will allow, something they may not allow as per government notification, etc. Because the more color you allow monopolize, then Vibjar, you know, the rainbow colors are there and a combination of them. You cannot get you will get depleted out of the colors to be given to other people. Okay. So that is a point which we'll have to understand. And so the color mark, as far as in foreign countries are concerned, Cadbury's purple color wrapper is approved by the Court of London. Okay. Then this is other one, we call it as olfactory mark or smell mark, which is used for perfumes. Nowadays they are allowing certain smells also to be trademarked. That this particular perfume or a food comes with that aroma or the flavor, that becomes a olfactory mark or a smell mark. And in recent times, very recent times, I have also came across that the layout of stores means, when you go to a shopping mall, you have a shop and you have the cash counter, the pickup area, other things, where you lay out the goods. How do you spread the goods for the easy access of the visitors and your consumers is also trademarkable. Very recently, this has been introduced in some countries. So maybe in India also, you can expect that, okay, if you go to a Bata store everywhere, this is like this, the layout will be everywhere. It will be similar layout of the store all over the place. So they are trying to make sure that the layout is not infringed upon by others, right? I finished kinds of mark. I think it is more clear. Now this is slide has been repeating in the last two sessions. Then this is also here. You can see the trademarks, logos, representative symbols used in trade and commerce. What is the term of protection? It is perpetual. But what happens is, when it is given, it is for a period of 10 years, and it can be renewed for another period of 10 years like that, and it can go on continuously, right? Now let's come to the effect of registration of trademark. What is the effect of registration of trademark? See, let us talk about Section 27. No action for infringement of unregistered trademark. No person shall be entitled to institute any proceedings to prevent or to require damages for the infringement of an unregistered trademark. If you are running a trademark, if you're using a trademark and you're not registered it, and somebody infringes upon it, although you may be using it for the last 20 years, you cannot take infringement action against them. All that this section allows you, or this clause recognizes, is the common law rights of the trademark owner to take action against any person for passing of goods as the goods of another person or as services provided by another person or the remedies thereof. It is a common law remedy is available for this unregistered trademark. So therefore, what it makes sense is to register the trademark. Now, Section 28 provides, what is the effect of registration? It provides exclusive rights to the registered proprietor of the trademark in relation to the goods or services in respect of which the trademark is registered, and to obtain relief in respect of infringement. So in kind of an infringement, see, there we can differentiate these two things. One is the infringement part of it. Another is the passing off part of it. So in the with respect to infringement, only if your mark is registered, you can get a remedy. And for that, the registration of your trademark under, as mentioned in Section 31 of the Act, is a prima facie evidence in any court of law. So let's talk about the registration. I stress the importance of registration. Let's talk about the registration procedure of trademark. So the registration procedure of trademark, so as I said, to prevent infringement of the trademark, registration is required. The process is simple. You can go and apply online for the registration in form TMA, either as an attorney or an advocate, or as a trademark agent, or as an individual user. So you can file the documents online using digital signature certificate. If you are an attorney, you take a general power of attorney from the client, like your wakalat, and then on a stamp paper, and then you can upload it using a digital signature, and also the image of the trademark, whatever the image, if it is a device or the word, you can put that image file also, and then create the thing, and then enter the details of the proposed user or existing user of the mark. That means whether the mark has been used, say for example, somebody must be using a mark for the past 5-6 years, he might not have registered it. So in that case, you can create an affidavit, user affidavit, that this mark has been used for the last 6 years, give some evidence to that effect, and then file that affidavit also in addition to your general power of attorney, as well as the image of the image file of the mark. Okay. But if you are going to be using it newly, you are proposed to be used, then you mention, you tick the column as proposed to be used. The mark is proposed to be used in the future, and then file the application. So either it can be filed as a proposed to be used or as an existing user of the mark. If you are saying that you are existing user of mark, the existing user means unless it is more than 2 years old, it doesn't have a standing in the examination. See, unless it is more than 2 years old, that you have been using it, and you should be able to provide evidence that I have been using it for the last 3 years or 4 years or 5 years, there should be an invoice or mark used for purchase or whatever. The mark should have been used very effectively, and you should have evidence to prove that, to show that that is the particular thing. Now, if the application is in order, it may be accepted and advertised in the trademark journal. Then there is a 4 months waiting period for any opposition from the public or interested person prior to issue of certification. Okay. So once your mark is approved, say let's assume that you are trying to file a proposed to be used mark. The mark is going to be proposed to be used in the near future. So you have filed an application. Now there is no other mark. I'll be talking about the other aspects of examination and Section 11, 9 and 11 relevance, absolute grounds and relative grounds of refusal by the trademark registry. So if no such observations are found under Section 9 and Section 11 of the Trademark Act, they will allow it to be accepted and then advertised in the trademark journal. So once it is advertised in the trademark journal, it will be waiting for a period of 4 months for any opposition from the public or any interested person. Interested person means who has got an earlier mark registered, which is relatively similar to your mark, or exactly same as a mark, who can create an this thing, or maybe is under the same category of goods as you are doing it. So in the event of any objections received from trademark registry for the filed application, reply needs to be filed within 30 days. See, all the IP proceedings are all time-bound actions. If you don't take time-bound action, they will say your application has been abandoned, and that's the end of it. You will have to go about reapplying once again. That's a part of it. So everything, you have to do it on time-bound. Of course, this reply needs to be filed within 30 days is a stipulated thing. And you can also, there is a TMM form which you can file and seek for another extension of another 30 days or so for that. So sometimes what the counter you file for the objections on your application, it may be accepted by the trademark registry and it may be published again. But sometimes if the counter what you have filed is not acceptable to them, then you will be given an opportunity for hearing either through video conference or by personal hearing to argue your points for the allowance of the mark for your claim. I hope this procedure is clear. So as I said, enter the details of the proposed user or existing user of the mark and pay the required government fees. And now here the government fees also varies according to the applicant. The applicant could be an individual or sole proprietor or a startup firm or company, a small entity which is comes under the MSME Act, which is SME unit, small and medium enterprises unit, and others. And others are basically the body corporate like private limited companies and limited companies or other institutions like societies or other things as I talked about. So the fees are different. So for example, a startup will get 50, startup and small entity will get 50% of the fees, which is normally payable by a body corporate, although they may be a body corporate. See, for example, a startup company or a small entity could be a private limited company. If they are registered under the startup scheme of Government of India or under the MSME registration, the Udayam registration or whatever it is, they need not pay 100% of the fees to the government. They get a 50% reduction on the trademark filing fees. These are the advantages for the people who want to go for incentives given by the government to promote trademark registrations more. Okay, almost in a year, lakhs and lakhs of trademarks are being registered and opposed and countered, etc. Now, if the application is in order, it may be accepted and registered trademark and waiting period. I talked about it, and proprietor can start using the trademark TM. You can see here the symbol of TM within circle. That can be used during the waiting period, and R must be used only after the registration. R within circles should be used only after registration. Now let's look into the proposal of objection handling. The objection handling, what I say is the objection which are raised by the trademark registry. These are the common objection which are coming falling under the two sections of the Act only, which is section 9.1 to 9.3, and each section 9.1 has got 2-3 classes. Similarly, 9.3 has got 2-3 classes. I mean, 9.2, 9.3 has got some subsections. So the first class, section 9, is absolute ground for refusal of registration. So what I talked about is, if the mark is devoid of any distinctive character, it is not capable of distinguishing the goods of or services of one person from those of another person, it is liable to be rejected under the absolute grounds of refusal for 9.1. It is a strong objection. So you will have to counter it and then show. Then if the mark consists of marks or indications may be, designate the kind, quality, quantity, intended purpose, values, geographical origin, or the time of production of goods or others, other characteristics of the goods also, it will be rejected. What does it mean? You cannot show the intended purpose. For example, I want to teach mathematics. I want to go and file a trademark for that. So I know that I go for a trademark called as Ganit Guru. If I say Ganit Guru, it means that it is a descriptive. It is very, very intended purpose is very clear. Guru means teacher, Ganit means mathematics. So the mathematics teacher. So I am going to teach mathematics through YouTube, through whatever it is. I want to use this Ganit Guru as my trademark. That will not be allowed. There is no distinction. There is no distinction because it is showing the intended purpose. That is what section 9 says. Section 9.1.9.2 says the intended purpose should not be there. It should be distinctive and not descriptive. I reiterate this point. It should be distinctive and not descriptive. And it cannot be a word from the dictionary. You can coin a new word. You can coin a new word. For example, even for that matter, if you say Pepsi, PepsiCo, or Pepsi. Pepsi does not, nobody knows what does Pepsi do. I mean, Pepsi means a cola. I mean, it does not indicate that particular thing directly, right? So certain things we'll have to look at it from that angle, but some would have assumed the distinction by a continuous use, like Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola indicates cola only, but that they were the first people who invented and then come out into that. So by continuous usage, the distinction has been gained by them. So that is a point which we'll have to understand with respect to this. So when you are going for absolutely new registration without having any previous use, you ensure that you fall in line with section 9 and 11 to ensure that your mark gets through without much of a problem. What is it in, it should not be customary in the current language or in established practices of trade. So it should not be in such a way it should deceive the public or cause confusion in the public. These are the points which you need to look into it. So that is one. And then you cannot use any mark to hurt religious sentiments or scandalous or obscene matter. Cannot be filed as a trademark. Then you have prohibition of national emblems and other things. Section 9.3 covers that. So let's go into objection handling, the second slide, where I'm talking about section 11.1 to 11.11, that is relative grounds of for refusal of registration. So that means its identity is with the earlier. Most of the time you will find 11.1 objection coming from the trademark registry. They will say your mark is identical to, and then they'll throw out some three or four or two or three similarity. That is, as I said, deceptively similar to those marks. It is similar to the mark and the same class of goods it is coming in, services. So there'll be likelihood on the confusion of the public with the earlier mark, which has been already registered. So that is the reason why you like. Nowadays, even the register of companies is not allowing you to register companies in which there is already a trademark exists. I think the computerization has taken effect. And they will not allow you to register a company for which the name of that is already registered in the trademark registry. You'll have to get a no objection from that particular company or the other entity to get your company name also registered. These are all the recent developments, which is identical or similar to earlier registered trademark. First, as I said, is identity or similar to the goods or services of the earlier mark. Like somebody is making a tobacco, is making use of tobacco and making cigarettes. I am making use of tobacco and making something else, or pan or good car, whatever it is. So, but both are same goods. So the same brand cannot coexist, and that identity or similarity of goods or services. That is what identity of similarity of the goods or services. But the other point is identical with the logo or the earlier registered mark in whichever way. Also, it should not be, especially with respect to well-known trademark, you cannot touch it. It will be detrimental to the character or reputation of the earlier trademark. For example, Bata India Limited is there. Now somebody goes and then say, I cannot put new Bata India Limited in this standard. New Bata India Limited is already affecting a well-known trademark. So you cannot do that. And then that is prohibited. And a trademark shall not be registered by virtue of any law, in particular passing of protection, and by virtue of law of copyright. I talked about copyright. If the mark is already copyrighted, then it will not be allowed to be trademarked. Now we are coming to the important session of infringement of trademark, where I talk about honesty and fair play are ought to be the basic policies in the world of trade and commerce or the business. So we expect honesty and fair play. So when a person intends to adopt a name in connection with his business or service, which already belongs to someone else, it results in confusion, and it has propensity of diverting the customers and clients of someone else to himself, and thus resulting in injury. How does the injury is caused? I am a manufacturer of, say, I am manufacturing some football. There is another brand manufacturer is already existing. I put the same brand and then start selling it. So what am I doing? I'm taking hold of somebody's reputation and then piggyback on that reputation and try to gain customers. And I sell it at cheaper price than the other person. So what happens? I get more customers or clients. Services means I get more clients where I start servicing them with my brand. Okay. So when I do that, the injury is caused to the registered owner of the trademark. That is what the infringement section talks about. Section 9 describes the 9 kinds of infringement trademarks in each of its 9 subsections. Okay, there are 9 subsections in section 29. It talks about the infringement classes which are there. So what is the action for the infringement? It is a statutory remedy conferred on the registered property of the trademark. that vindication of the exclusive right to use the trademark in relation to these goods. That means any invention of the right of this right by another person using a mark which is same or deceptively similar to this trademark, he can protect it by obtaining injunction. So what are the first thing you can get it? The moment you find somebody is trying to use a mark which is similar to yours, you can go and protect it if you have registered your trademark. Because as we talked about unregistered trademark, there is no protection. You can only file a, you can only get a common law remedy under passing off. But as far as infringement is concerned, if you are registered trademark, only if you are registered trademark, you get the remedy by way of injunction. You can get an injunction the moment you have the interim injunction will be given once you show your prima facie evidence of a registration itself by the court. Okay. Next, what is needed by way of cause of action for filing of a suit of infringement of trademark is the use of deceptively similar mark, which may not be identical. Okay, it is a deceptively similar, but it need not be exactly identical. Okay, it may be deceptively similar to that. So the plaintiff can succeed in the action for infringement if he proves that an essential particular of his trademark has been copied. Say what I said is, in case of the make my trip form, it says make my trip is my thing. Other person is trying to register get my trip. Make my trip and get my trip, the word is only different get, but otherwise my trip is a particular element or essential particular of my, the essential component of my trademark. So that is the point on which you can seek for the infringement action against the defendant, and you can prove it in the court of law and get an interim injunction immediately. An action for infringement of trademarks, you'll have to understand the difference between an infringement and passing off. That is the last point which describes. An action for infringement of trademarks is aimed at protecting the trademark itself. So what does it do? It protects the trademark itself, whereas an action of passing off is aimed at protecting the goodwill or reputation associated with the trademark. By selling you the same good, what happens is the original brand becomes a duplicate brand or a counterfeit brand. So that means your reputation and goodwill is spoiled by the other person. So the use by the defendant of the trademark of the plaintiff is not essential in action of passing off, but this is sine qua non in case of an action for infringement, right? So let us quickly go through some case laws. I think I'm exceeding my time. Maybe another 10 minutes I will take and try to wrap up this session, because it's a vast subject. Trademark is a very interesting subject and vast subject. And even if I start discussing the case laws and how our courts have been awarding judgments, I think it will take more than 3 days for me, or 4 days, for 4 sessions, 5 sessions to go through it. So let's take a glimpse of what are the essential case laws here. So we know it's one of the olden days story, Jagmag Electric and Radio Company versus Telerad Private Limited, AR 1977 from Delhi, 152. So the respondent, that is the Telerad, coined the word Telerad. See, this is what I said. It is a distinct word and it is a coined word. You can also use a coined word. It need not be a dictionary meaning. Dictionary meaning is this: Telerad means television plus radio. That is what it is. Put together, Telerad. So you can coin a new word. You will not find Telerad in the dictionary, but you will find television and radio in the dictionary. So it should not be descriptive. That is why the distinction comes into picture when you are naming a trademark, when you are trying to create a new trademark. I reiterate that again and again, that you should have a distinctness to your trademark. It should not be descriptive or find a meaningful word in the dictionary. This is first and foremost. So the Telerad was extensively used, and it was acquired in reputation of use of expression Telerad by the appellant for its products. Was the same Telerad was tried to be used by the Jagmag Electric and Radio Company for its products, and they were trying to use the Telerad for the water heater, something like the mug kind of a heater. So although Telerad was using for television sets, the use of this brand for this was found to be not bona fide, and the court held that only the registered trademark should be used. Otherwise it will create confusion to the public, and it will become an unfair trade practice, because people will think it is coming from Telerad. They will go and buy Jagmag Electronic product, electric company's product, assuming that it is coming from Telerad. It creates a confusion in the market. So the court has upheld the rights of Telerad and the brand of Pellad was held. Now this is another important case, as you see the last para of the slide. This is Cartier International AG versus another against a online commercial website, e-commerce website, digas.com, in 2014 in Delhi High Court. It was a case of counterfeit products of the plaintiff sold through online portal for watch brand. Cartier is a French watch brand, and their watches are very expensive and highly renowned brand, like the Swiss watches. Cartier watches are world famous. But the defendant, he made some replica brands from Ludhiana, Punjab, and started selling it to many customers and cheated many customers and passed off the goods as that of the original plaintiff, like Cartier International brand itself. So Section 135 of the trademark provides for the relief. The plaintiff in the instance suits opted for damages, and the competition thereof was accepted by the court. The damages was accepted by the court. In addition, since the digas.com people did not come up in the court and other things, the court went ahead and also given a punitive damages of rupees 1 crore was awarded. So this is an exceptional case in India, because the courts have started recognizing the values of the brands and the trademarks in the Indian market and the protection of the intellectual property rights. Because if the same thing, an Indian company goes and operates in a foreign company, we need a national treatment there also. Our brand should not be copied, because we already have our pharma company's products are being counterfeited by China and sold under the same name to African countries. India is a big pharmaceutical exporter. The brand names of these drugs are being counterfeited world over and being used. Even for that matter, the Darjeeling tea has been counterfeited by Kenyans and Sri Lankans. They say Darjeeling tea, and if you see the manufacturer, it will be Sri Lankan address. And Darjeeling tea, when it is not made and manufactured by Darjeeling or Tea Board of India, how can it be a original Darjeeling tea? We'll cover that, some of those aspects in geographical indications. But for the limited extent, we'll see that this courts have started recognizing the IPS and started protecting it and awarded punitive damages also. Well, this is another, this is another important case law, where you see the Ferrero Rocher. Everybody would have seen these chocolates, would have enjoyed these chocolates. And there was a case of Ferrero versus Piyush Devangan, and another. It is basically against the Ferrero Rocher chocolates versus the Delizy chocolate, because as you see there, the Delizy is also a deceptively similar packaging. Okay, now in this concept, what we call it as the trade dress. It was packaged similar to Ferrero Rocher, almost similar, deceptively similar, as we talk about. In this unique point of the case is that even though the traditional trademark, that is the brand name, like Ferrero Rocher and Delizy are dissimilar, they are not similar, they are dissimilar. However, it does not mitigate the possibility of being sued for trademark infringement and passing off if the packaging is deceptively similar. So here, the packaging is deceptively similar. Somebody would buy a Delizy thinking it to be a Ferrero Rocher. It creates a confusion in the marketplace. So this is a concept of trade dress. There is no provision for protection of trade dress in India as per the act, I'm talking about. But still the courts have recognized and are awarding judgments in favor of protecting the trade dress as well. Now, this is another case which I was talking about, tobacco, which is Vishnudas trading as Vishnudas versus Wazir Sultan Tobacco Tobacco Limited, VST. It was a 1996 case. In the early 80s, there was a new brand. The jeans revolution started. People were smoking a new brand of cigarette called Charm started coming up with a jeans color pack and all that. I don't know if it exists now or not. During my college days, I used to see that Charm's brand. That Charm's cigarette, that's what VST manufactures. And then this Vishnudas also started manufacturing chewing tobacco. This is a smoking tobacco. Cigarettes is a smoking tobacco, whereas Vishnudas was making a chewing tobacco. Both were using a brand called Charminar. Charminar case, we call it as a Charminar case. They use the logo of Charminar as their brand image. So Charminar cigarettes, Charminar or Charms or Charminar cigarette was the brand. And Vishnudas also was using another image of Charminar. So there was a contention what should be protected. So one, but both are coming under the same class of goods. Okay, both are tobacco. This is also tobacco, that is also tobacco. However, the Supreme Court said it cannot be, trademark cannot be monopolized. That means a particular class, a particular person has been allotted, it cannot be given that he is going to manufacture all the products in the class. He is Wazir Sultan Tobacco Company, VST company, is only manufacturing smokable cigarettes. It is not manufacturing or had any plans of manufacturing chewable tobacco. So you should not restrict the other people under the same class making different product. And then the concept of enlarging the field of registrability was brought in better. Otherwise, each class one company will take and then they'll monopolize it. That is not the meaning of the Trademark Act. So the Trademark Act does not monopolize each and every class of the goods to only one person. One tobacco manufacturer has done, no other tobacco manufacturer cannot be permitted. That's not the case. So that is against the act. So that is what is the thing. Similarly, in Kadila Healthcare versus Kadila Pharmaceutical, where the court held, the Honorable Supreme Court held that it is well recognized in principle that in deciding a question of similarity between two marks, how both marks are similar, the marks have to be considered as a whole. It should not be dissected. See, in this case, Kadila is the same name, but one is Kadila Healthcare, another is Kadila Pharmaceuticals. So you cannot bisect the name, take it out Kadila and say this Kadila and that Kadila are the same. No, that is what they said, they should consider as a whole. The true test is whether the totality of the proposed trademark is such that it is likely to cause deception or confusion or mistake in the minds of person accustomed to the existing trademark. If somebody is used to Kadila Healthcare trademark, he is not going to go into Kadila Pharmaceutical product. Say, for example, in the previous case, what we are talking about in the chewing tobacco and smokable tobacco cigarette, we know the person who wants to smoke a cigarette, he will go and buy only Charminar cigarette. The person who wants to chew tobacco will go and buy Charminar chewable tobacco. He will not go and buy the cigarette. So the user, there is no confusion. He knows this Charminar brand is a chewable tobacco. The other user knows this is a this Charminar brand is a smokable cigarette. So they will go on. The user knows there is no confusion for the user. If both are offering the same product, then only the confusion comes into picture. So when both are products, a product by itself are different, the name by dissecting the name and then trying to say these are common is not acceptable. Supreme Court has clarified on that. Okay, let me conclude with the case law of Patanjali Ayurved versus Arudra Engineering. This is the latest judgment in February, I think 8th February 2021. Our Madras High Court, a division bench of Justice R. Subbaiah and Justice C. Saravanan passed the order observing that there was no prima facie case of trademark infringement made out against Patanjali Ayurved. So Patanjali Ayurved had made a coronal brand of COVID protection tablets. They were releasing it under Ayush Ministry, and they were trying to get a WHO approval also for this Ayurvedic tablets. In the meantime, Arudra Engineering Private Limited filed a suit saying that they are the owners of the trademark Coronil 92B and Coronil 213 for acid inhibitor product in industrial clinic. Their product is used in an industrial clinic. And they said this Coronil word is, so again, going by this Kadila Healthcare case, the same thing was applied by the Honorable Madras High Court and then stated that it is a composite mark consisting of the words and numerals put together. It cannot be dissected. If Arudra has obtained a composite mark as Coronil alone, then there is a question of confusion there that can arise in the market. So they have protected the, they allowed Patanjali Ayurved to use the brand Coronil for COVID protection tablets. This is the recent judgment of this month at our Honorable Madras High Court. Now, the remedies for infringement, the civil remedies, injunction, damages, and accounts of profits, these are the things we saw in the Cartier case where they went in for damages and a punitive damage of 1 crore was awarded. Criminal remedies are offered. This is there is a huge section from 101 to 121, which covers the thing. Imprisonment of 6 months to 3 years with a fine not less than 50,000, extend up to 3 lakhs, I think, 3 lakhs or 2 lakhs. Search and seize infringing products by the police. So administrative remedies also available through Intellectual Property Appellate Board, where in any correction in assignments, transmission, rectification, or other administrative remedies are available through this thing. So we have seen the case law. Just I'm summing up the remedies which are available. Both civil and commercial remedies are available.